Jared is out. He's out tonight. Asked me to go before him, and we said we want to stay with where you've been going, okay? And something here with the city can be rented at all farm. I know where we're at, what's going on. So we're going to continue in Colossians tonight, okay? So we're still in chapter 2. So we can go ahead and turn there. We're going to continue on in verse 7. But beforehand, we have to keep with the program and answer our questions. By now, you ought to know this. Colossians was written by who?
God.
By the hand of?
Paul.
To who?
The
church at Colossae, here at Colossians. And the guy who delivered it.
No, it's 17.
Someone none of us can say. Cuticus.
Cuticus.
Yeah? Yeah. It's like, it'd be a good name for a rapper. But I don't know what else you do with that. Yeah, you know, but anyway, all right. And what was going on at the church? They had some messed up beliefs. They were a bit confused. But guess what? They didn't have a written Bible to look at. So you can understand they'd be a little confused, right?
Right.
Do you have some stuff you're confused about? I mean, if you're really honest about it, there's some stuff you don't get, right? Right. We all have a few pieces of that. So luckily they had Paul to write to them and do this. So we're going to go back and we're going to look at the next part of this tonight. Somebody let me know when it's 8:30. Gosh, I got some. Anyway, all right, let's read it in verse 6 so we get the whole verse in here. So then, just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live in Him, rooted and built up in Him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. Okay? Now, last week we talked about what? Being rooted. And Jared made a great point. And I did go back and double check it with the Greek to make sure I knew the language of it on there. In the Greek, it does separate rooted and built up. So it says rooted in Him and built up in Him. So it's two separate things. So we're going to talk about that in just a minute. But to kick the theme of it just a little bit, we have the slides. Let's see if we have slides. Somebody can do hum the Jeopardy song. Because that's where we're going anyway, is to Jeopardy. Okay, I'm going to introduce the world.
There
we go.
Obey
some obeying, do what? centered on others. Okay, that's a good point. To become perfect. Eventually we will be, right? As Christians. It's not happening on this side. Okay? I don't see it coming anytime soon in my life to be perfect in it. But more and more like Him. Describe Jesus. What was He like? Compassionate.
Persistent.
Okay. Once He was accurate, He was accurate. What do you think? Unconditional. He was loving, wasn't He? Okay. Now, we can say He was totally sold out to God, but He is God. So that's kind of tougher for us to put our hands on that. But He was all about what God had called Him to do, and He was all about sharing that love with other people. His focus was on serving God. So as we are built up, that's what we become. But this idea of being built carries with it the idea that it's a process, right? If you were to decide, or worse yet, if I were to decide, to run a marathon next week, what would that look like? How would you do it? Okay, some of you run, okay? You're out of this conversation. You're one of those crazy people that runs all the time? Without somebody chasing you? Okay?
I would say we're at the shortest marathon.
Okay, how long do you envision those things? 4 hours or something? Yeah, I think about like day three when I crawl across. That I'd be wishing I'd prepared a little better, right? So if you're going to do some sort of sport or athletic event, you got to train, don't you? Okay? You got to put that in place. I did spend one season coaching high school football years ago, and we would see these guys would show up thinking, I don't want to play football. They never played. They lay around all summer playing video games and stuff and soda. And that first day of practice was a lot like my first day of seventh grade right now. Okay? Where you're over in the corner with your head hanging in a bucket because you're not prepared. Okay? You haven't built yourself ready for this. The same thing is true in our Christian life. Okay? And I'm going to figure out how to illustrate that here in just a second. We have to be willing to allow this process to happen, but we have to get it in order. So let's go to the next slide, if we can get there. Okay, see if you can get me to the funny looking. It's that next funny looking one that comes up there. And I'll talk until you get it. There we go. This is a
tree.
But notice this tree has grown a bit, right? Just being rooted in
properly a tree grows. So, for us as Christians, just being connected to Jesus, there's a certain amount of stuff that happens in our life, right? Okay? From the moment you get saved, there's a change that begins. There's a life that starts. Eternal life starts at that moment. Okay? Because it doesn't end. It starts at that point. It keeps going. So you are connected. At that moment, you become a child of God. You don't have to do anything else later on to try to become God's child. Okay? So you are put in that position. Okay? So you have the connection with Jesus. You are called a brother to Christ. You are called joint heirs. You are called saints. There's a lot of cool words that go along with that. And it's the fact that you are connected to God changes your identity. Okay? And so now you have the ability to grow your full potential, to have the connection, the intimate relationship with God, and you have the opportunity for eternal life in heaven. So those things automatically come. Okay? But does that solve everything you run into in your life?
Have you had some junk since you've been a Christian?
Yeah, I have. We do. We still run into junk. And we have to deal with that stuff and come to God to get that. So at this point, this is like if Tim were to grab you and say, you now are in the band.
Okay? And you're thinking, yes.
Finally. And he puts you up on stage. You are in the band, right? Nothing else has happened, but you're in the band.
I think it was like, oh my, he's coming up on stage now.
But he pulls you up. But there's a little more to that, isn't there? Because what happens a lot of times, there are people running around in our churches that are not connected to Jesus, right? You think there's people in your church that are not saved?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there are. Some of us have been that person one time or another, haven't we? Okay? That goes on. Well, it's some folks are here maybe because their parents made them. There you go. Okay, understand that. And some because they're trying to learn or trying to get something. And I think God honors that, eventually teaches it to us. But some folks are just hanging out. Okay? So if I take one of you and I put you up here with Tim and the guys, and you look like you're part of the band, do you have any idea what to do? Okay. If he handed you a guitar, would that fix it? Probably not. Okay, for most of us. But you might look like a part of it and feel really cool. Okay. But that can get a little confusing for some of us. Let's see the next slide. This is what happens to us. This is you as a tree rooted in Jesus, but not built up in Him. Okay. You have Zippo strength. Okay. You don't have what you need to deal with the stuff in life if you're just sitting there. Okay. If this is the kind of person shows up on Sunday morning and says, I did my religious duty, I did what my parents told me to do, I was happy, there's a checklist, I'm done. And that's the end. But we don't grow that way, do we? Okay. Maybe just a little, like moss. So instead of a tree, you're moss. Or pew moss. You're on the side of the pew. That'll be the one thing you remember. What y'all talking about? It's something about pew moss. But now, the idea here is we can hang around and never grow and say, I'm saved, it's good enough. And you know what you are? Nothing can ever take that away from you. Okay? Understand. Nothing will rip you. We talked about it last week. But nothing can rip you out of His hand ever again. But there's this other side. If you want the life He promised, the full life that Jesus said you would get in John 10:10, then we have to go through this building up process. Show me the next one. Okay. This is you as a tree rooted in Jesus and built up in Him. Okay? You get a little spiritual muscle that goes with that. Some of you guys are thinking, how do I get that? But, yeah, we're talking spiritually with this, and we want to put this together. Okay? Why is this important? Why is growing to be like Jesus going to be important? Yeah, it is. I mean, we talk about it all the time, but why? Anybody? Why is it important to become like Jesus? That's a good point. faith, if you love me, you'll obey my commands. So if we're responding to love him, we're going to want to obey. Okay? Now, do they all get obeyed all the time?
No.
But we try. That's the key to growth, is we're trying. Because we love God, we want to try to do it. But it's important because Jesus tells us we'll have persecution in life. We're going to have hard times. We're going to bump up against junk. And we can either let that junk knock us down and mess us up, or we can be tapped into Jesus in such a way that we're growing and we're feeding off him and we can deal with stuff. Does having a relationship with Jesus give you a magic button to get rid of the junk?
We've got to study. We've got to be willing to try to obey. Like I said a while ago, you're not going to obey every commandment all the time, are you? You may try, but you're going to miss something. The key is, are you trying? Because the longer you do it, and the more you try, the better you'll be at it. Okay? I mean, I can ask back here, Tim, with the music thing. Tim, you get better as you go?
No.
You just keep improving? I know he does. Somebody else. The more you do something, the better you should get at it. So the more we focus on doing the things that make us like Him, of trying to act like Him, of worshiping Him, of spending time in His Word, then we will become more like Him. Show me the next one up there, if you would. There's the how you do it. Okay, that is like the only thing I can find left. So the first thing that's going to happen, again, the root inside, is actually giving your life to Jesus. I mean, does it do you any good to try to act like Him if you're not connected to Him? That doesn't do any good. Okay? That's definitely just kind of faking. You're not going to earn your way there, so you may as well just take it. Well, let's change it this way. If you came to me and said, hey, lady, can I have $20? First reality is I wouldn't have it. So, but if you did, how about if I said this? Okay, here's your choice. Here's $20. You go mow the yard and clean up after the dog and you can have it. Or you can just have it. What are you going to take?
The first one, so you can give more money later.
You were really confused. What about your parents? If you went in and said, hey, you know, can I have $20? And they said, well, go mow the yard. Your response is probably, why can't you just give it to me? You at least thought it. You may not have said it, but you at least thought it. But why don't we do the opposite to God? When God offers us freely His love, and a relationship, why do we come back and say, I've got to do something to earn that? It's too easy. There's got to be a catch somewhere. So the first step, though, is just willingly acknowledging it and connecting with it. Then we've got the learning situation. You know, we've got to spend the time getting to know God. And I'm not talking about having to go into deep theology. You don't have to come and sign up for Bible courses at the college with us. You don't have to do that. But just get to know God. See the personal side of who He is and what goes on in your life. And then exercise. Actually do something. When's the last time you did something with your faith? That's getting into business. But those moments when we see people who are hurting and we know they're hurting and we need to say something to them, sometimes we have to step up. Or maybe God's showing us something we need to change in our lives and not sure if we want to, but we know it's right, it's best for us. Sometimes we have to take that step and say, you know what? I'm going to touch every spiritual muscle I've got and try to do this. Okay? That's exercising our faith. Paul tells us in 1 Timothy 4, 8, that physical exercise has a little bit of value. That's the fact that you guys are like runners. But, more importantly, train yourself to be God. It's an actual conscious decision to work in to become like Jesus. Is it hard for us? Not necessarily. Okay? Because, for Peter tells us that God has already given us everything we need for a godly life. What is it that through those roots connects with us and gets in us and causes us to grow? Any idea? When you give your life over to Jesus, the Bible tells us very clearly that the Holy Spirit, God's actual Spirit, comes to live in you, to guide you, to comfort you, to counsel you, and to encourage you and give you strength to do stuff. But we forget that, don't we? I forget sometimes when things are challenging in my life that all I have to do is say, God, I know you're here. I know you're inside me. I need to tap into something. We have to make that choice to do it. Okay? Take that exercise. Obey even when it hurts. Because some decisions are hard, especially if it's quitting something. Okay? That's a tough one. But sometimes we've got to make that hard call. Let God help, and I would say get a partner. Okay? If you're an exercise buff and you're working out, isn't it easier with because you encourage each other, probably maybe because you're working in their herd as much as you are. But the idea here is you've got somebody with you. The Bible tells us that two are better than one because if one gets tired, the other can help. Isn't that pretty neat? That God would put it like that? So it really becomes three. You got the Holy Spirit with you, and then you got your buddy with you that's going on a little further. So that's kind of the thought on this as we put that together. Let me see the last thing that was on there. I think I had one more. There we go. Back to this idea of being a tree. Okay? Jeremiah 17, 7 and 8 said, "Blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in Him. It will be like a tree planted by the water. It sends out its roots by the stream. It does not fear when heat comes. Its leaves are always green. It has no worries in a year of drought. It never fails to bear fruit." When we choose to connect ourselves with God and trust Him and allow Him to build us up, that we're like that big, strong tree that grows close to the water source. And we can withstand the junk that comes out of our life. So, I'm going to end it with a question. And I'll have you guys come back up and kind of us worship and respond to that. But are you being built up? Are you growing? What happens to a muscle if it's not broken? You don't use it. It deteriorates. Down to nothing. Okay. We've got to stay active in building ourselves up and letting God grow us. And the cool thing is, every one of us can do it. Every one of us can be growing more and more like Jesus. We've got a great moment for that. Because God doesn't really care about the details of who you are that will keep you from becoming something in this world. He's not worried about, you know, how tall we are, how cool we are, who our parents are. You know, the way your hair stands up, falls out, or changes colors, or any of that kind of stuff. It's just attitude. Everybody with that equal chance to become who's made to be. So there's your challenge. This week, find a place to exercise spiritual muscle. If you're at a place where this is causing some questions or some struggles in your life, I'm going to pop our adults and just kind of say be visible and out here when we go back into worship here. So if you've got a question, you've got somebody, just kind of pray with them. Catch one of the adults out here. Spend some time praying with them and get some encouragement. Pray with them, and I'll let you guys stay strong. Father, I thank you, first off, that you give your life to us, that you put your very self inside of us when we become yours, that you give us the strength and the abilities to deal with life, to have joy even when things are tough, that you care about us enough to keep us strong, to build us up, and love on us. I didn't pray for those of us here tonight. I know we've got some here probably that have never connected their heart to you. Some of us that are struggling with different parts of sin or struggling to act out our faith, I ask you to encourage us, Father. To give us strength and to help us to encourage each other too. We give you glory. We give you praise.